Of Tron episode 13. This one's called The Stranger. And sorry, this review is going to come out so late. I know the episode was out Monday. Something happened. I normally record it, and the recording got interrupted. And then I've been waiting for the site that I go to just in case I miss it to upload it. For some reason, they uploaded it very late. Like, usually they do it like the next day. But this time it took them like 3 or 4 days later, so hence my late review. And you'll be getting a bunch of reviews from me today into tomorrow, because I may shoot them all in sequence, but my computer to render these videos once I edit them takes forever, so, and then the upload's even slower. So it may, you know, believe it or not, to do one of these videos, it may take me 10 to 15 minutes to shoot it. Then, because I'm using 1080p HD, it takes like another, you know, half hour to upload the video, and then to edit it and redo and put everything together, it may take about 2 hours or an hour and a half with my computer, depending on the length. And then to upload it, it could take upwards to like 4 hours. So, I mean, depending on the time of day of my connection, I have cable, but sometimes, you know, the upload to YouTube is slow. So, alright, well, now that I've gotten all that out of the way, so this episode starts off basically, Abel gives, Beck a mission, which is just a delivery. He has to deliver something in a town far, far away, he's told to stay on the roads, to make this delivery. You know, don't get off the main road. Just Galua, I believe is the name, or Galui, or something like that is the name of the town that he has to travel to. And he has to take the highway. So he starts speeding there and cuts in front of a couple cars and trucks, and he's nasty. And then it's bumper to bumper traffic. There's a bad storm, and there's no way to get around. So Beck decides to take dirt. To just get on the dirt and drive around it, because he's in a rush. And then the storm really acts up. It pushes him into this like pit where there's this like energy water thing. He falls into that, and he falls through the water and onto ground. And there's this standing obelisk mirror thing. It's kind of that looks kind of like a door, and it's kind of similar to you know, that crystal from, like, Superman, where, you know, the Phantom Zone crystal, only it's a, you know, it's a doorway. But, so he falls through it, you know, he falls through the looking glass, so to speak. And he gets introduced to another character. He's in a weird space that seems to defy logic. And that's when he runs into this character. And at the same time, Tron has a mission for Beck. Beck's not around, so him and Abel argue about it. And he's like, well, Dyson's up to something, and I have to go investigate it. And Abel goes, I'll go. So Abel boards a transport to go to the capital city or whatever, to see what Dyson's up to. And, so that's the two stories. The Beck story and the Abel and Tron story. The fact that Abel and Tron get a story is, I like Abel and Tron as a duo, because they're these two guys who don't agree on anything, really. They're old friends, and they're just old friends who like to argue, you know what I mean? They're like the odd couple. That's the way I'll describe them. And the chemistry between them, I think, is really good on the series. The fact that they just don't agree on anything, it's just good. It's funny without the meaning for it to be funny, which is what I like. All right, so basically, let me just wrap up the Abel story now, and I'll get into the Tron story, or the Tron story, the Beck story. So Abel's story is simple. He goes to the town. He pretends to be a worker. They give him the speech about do what you're told and all that. He basically goes down to a level, and then he sneaks off and overhears Dyson talking about the weapon that they're building. But he doesn't know what it is they're building. And basically, that's why they're all there, the workers, building this machine that nobody really knows, because they're only building one small component at a time, what it's going to be. Dyson questions Abel when he notices him lurking around, and Abel's like, I'm lost, blah, blah, blah. And then the guard that is responsible for Abel vouches for him. Now, for a second there, I was like, is he in on it? You know, but he wasn't, because after getting yelled at by Dyson, he smacks Abel, like, what are you doing? So I'm like, all right, whatever. So then they end up going to... then the day ends up, you know, they go back to work, the day ends, and everybody's leaving. Now, both when he got there and now when he's supposed to be leaving, there's a ledge, because they're on top of some sort of building, and so he keeps looking over the edge, and so Dyson goes to him, hey, where are you off to? And he's like, and he's looking to get away, but all the transports are closing and whatnot, and the security force appears behind him. He goes, you know, I never got to see your disc. See, this is what I love about Dyson. He's that good. He doesn't buy bullshit. He's good at his job. He's sort of the anti-Tron, you know? And what I'm noticing a lot in this series is there's the anti-versions. Obviously, Clue's the anti Flynn, right? Clue's the anti Flynn. Dyson's the anti Tron. And in a second, we'll get into the anti Beck, but that's the later part of the story. So, he gets surrounded, and it looks like it's no good. Tron shows up and helps him. In all black, I might add. No tea, nothing. All black. And they start fighting. Funny to see Abel fight, because he's also accidentally like elbowing people, and he doesn't mean for his moves to work, but they're working because he's old and rusty at fighting. And they're able to fight back the guards, and they're gonna go after Dyson. Dyson runs away, gets him into the bridge, and then what they were on was actually a giant ship, and that flies away, like, you know, the ships that are in the shape of like this, you know what I mean? They're kind of, I'm bad at it. But, you know, the square-shaped ships, this was a huge one. And he goes, well, now we know what weapon, you know, because the whole thing is they hadn't figured out what it was, and now they knew what it was. So they have to get back because, you know, now they know what it is, and now they know what they need to stop. All right, so that basically concludes that part of the story. Then we go and let me go get into the Beck part of the story. So he had just fallen into the obelisk, into the space that was weird. He runs into this guy, and I'll explain who he is in a second. But this guy who has like lines all across, like tribal looking lines all across his face that are lit up white, and that's the other thing. His energy is white. Same as a Tron or Beck when they go good. His is the white energy. And he knows who Beck is. He knows Beck by name. He checked his disc. He gave it back to him. And this... It starts off that he says he knows Tron. And they're on the same size. And he's cluing Beck into his plan. And what he plans to do. And they're on this giant electrode thing ball. And basically, his plan is to wipe out the grid, to save the grid by wiping it out and cleansing it. So he's wonkers, you know what I mean? We don't know how he got this way. We just know that he is. Now, When that happens, he goes, the only thing I've been missing is a power source. So Beck's like, I'll stop you. Then Beck gets kicked into the chair inside, and then he's strapped down in this chair where they're going to use him as a power source. And basically, you know, he's like, well, before he even gets in the chair, they start to fight. He's like, don't you wonder why I can predict all your moves? Because you and I are the same. And he does this, and it reveals the T. I was the first renegade. I was the first protege. And then he kicks him in the chair. But basically, who this guy is he's Jason Todd. If we're going with the Batman analogy, he's Jason Todd. You know, I wouldn't say obviously, it doesn't fit perfectly, but we get the gist. He's the bad Robin, right? Because... Now, when you watch the beginning of the episode and they catch you up with scenes from other episodes, one of them, obviously, they clue you in onto who he is. He's the guy who helped Tron escape the first time around when he was captured. And Tron has alluded that friendship clouded his judgment once. So this guy was the first guy he trained to be Tron. And obviously this dude went psychotic. Maybe the transfer didn't go right. What have you. But, either way, this guy's a bad guy. And he's a genius, and he was basically trapped in a half dimension. And he's looking to do this. So he's going to use Beck as a power source. Beck's getting electrocuted. Beck starts seeing crazy things. Beck sees, while he's sitting in the chair, he sees Tron. He sees the universe. He's from far away. Then it zooms in. Then he sees Beck. Then Beck sees Tron in his mind, trying to. Then he sees. I think it's Clue, not Flynn. Too. So he sees everything. He gets all metaphysical, and it's very weird. So then the machine starts breaking apart. You see, the machine had pushed forward, and it's like a giant Tesla, basically. It's a shaft with a ball on the top. Hey, you make your own judgments. It went through the water, out of the field, and with Beck no longer powering it, and it was not just Beck powering it. It was also this guy too. And they fight. Beck wins. Jumps off the thing before it breaks, and it falls back into the obelisk. The obelisk falls and cracks. Beck thinks it's over. This is when we catch up. So Beck gets back to Tron. You know, Tron's like, what happened? He's like, run in the middle of delivery. Went by the things, was lost for a little while. And he kind of lets Tron know he knows about it. And Tron's a little, like, unsure. He's like, yeah, because, you know, I was your first choice, right? Not first and only choice. And he's like, yeah. So there's a little bit of this. And, Beck's a little wary of Tron now. And then the classic horror movie ending, which I think was cheesy and over the top. You know, he crawls out of the broken shards of the mirror. I am alive, you know? And that's how they end the episode. Alright, so what did I think about this episode? I'm gonna give this episode a 3. Well, I like the introduction of the anti-Beck, you know, the anti-renegade. And I wanted a little more of a backstory to him. I wanted a flashback so we can get more on him. Not that he was this guy who helped save Tron, and now all of a sudden he's this villain. And we didn't get any story to fill in the gap. So, I didn't like, really like that. And to be honest with you, it took, for some reason, I don't know if it was the pacing, I don't know, there was something about this episode that just didn't do it for me. I don't know what it was. I literally had to rewatch this episode like 3 times before I actually, like, it wasn't holding my interest. You know what I mean? Like, I started zoning out, thinking of other things. You know what I mean? Like, playing with my phone. Like, it took me 3 times to watch it before I actually watched the thing. And I don't know what it is. I'm gonna give this a 3 because it wasn't a bad episode. It, by no means was it a bad episode. It was a good episode. But it just couldn't hold my attention. And I don't know what it is, because I like the Abel stuff. And I like the Beck stuff. But something about it just, didn't click for me on this episode. So I'm going to say this is probably the worst episode I've seen of Tron so far, but it's still a 3. So that's pretty good for the series, if the worst I can give it is a good. I mean, I don't know, tell me what you think. Tell me what you think of the anti-renegade. Tell me what you think of this budding alliance now, the beginning of an actual revolutionary movement. Now there's 3 of them instead of 2 of them. And what do you think about the fact that, you know, Dyson has now seen Abel's face? So if he goes back there to the garage and sees Abel's done. So there's stuff there. There's stuff to work with. But, all right. This is Alert Wolf here telling you to click it up if you like it. Comment if you must. Subscribe if you can. And I am out.